everybody out there. This is Chris Nicholson. I worked on this all day. I didn't have breakfast. I went out to a buffet for lunch and I filled myself up. I didn't actually have to eat until, you know, basically now. And hopefully I get a message now. Got my phone in my pocket. But I worked on this all day, did a lot of thinking, did a lot of restructure. There's a lot of things that I actually changed about this, because I looked at my grand piano and I saw things that were kind of a little bit wrong on this. So I'm like, okay, let me change them, which is no problem. First of all, if you can see, the sides are a lot better. I looked at the Steinway cheeks. And I designed them exactly like this, like the New York Steinway cheeks. I went the New York Steinway route instead of the Hamburg Steinway or a Yamaha or a Yongchang, as in some of the parts on here, because the pointed edges make it a lot easier to work with than trying to curve the edges of whatever you try to. The curved edges are really nice, but you also have to make the fall board, that's a train, curved edges. So that was one thing that I had to work on today. So that was 5 o'clock in the morning. Second thing is that the lid was too thick. I put a double lid on there. I took that off. I totally took that off, and I took the bottom lid, which was right here, and I reshaped it to the actual size around. So now it fits like a glove. It fits perfectly. It looks really, really nice around. I just lost reception right here, so I think it's right there. We're hearing trains and everything. We're at the house. But I shaped it around. It did, with the double lid, I mean, with the two-piece wood on here, it looked like a project that an inexperienced person was gonna actually do. The lid on here, it's basically like an inch thick, and when you fold it up, it's basically 2 inches thick. So I had to go micro with this one and make it half an inch thick, because when I basically flipped the front part of the lid to the back, from the head to the tail, it was too freaking thick. It was thicker than this one, so I took off the other part of the lid. I could still sit on the piano, which is really cool. But I want to make it more protective, that it's not going to move with the legs. The legs are, right now, they're using screws, so I'm going to find the right bolts, see how to put the bolt joints in and everything like that. Just basically it. Okay, so let me open up the pianos. So I'm going to open up the grand first. Once I open up the top of both of the pianos, of course, this is an acoustic, and this is a digital. It's not considered as a keyboard anymore. This is more of a digital grand piano workstation. You know, I mean, how can you put it? The lid lock was long. Was wrong. I'm sorry. My speech is bad. The lid log, which is this thing right over here, this is called a lid log. It was placed the wrong way, how I had it. And so, instead of, it was flat, and you can see its holes right here, those are the ovals. Now it's in an upright position, which is a lot better. It looks 10 times better. And later on, I thought about it, maybe I might want to put a lock right here, and probably make this piece a little bit thicker and put a lock right here, so I can actually, just like on that piano, close it up, lock it up with the key, and they'll be able to take a standard piano lock, which is pretty cool. All I have to do is make some edits, and that's very easy to make. I found out by taking apart this lock and taking apart Yamaha locks, I can actually make a lock for this piano. Once I lock the piano, you won't be able to open up the fall board or the moon, which is pretty cool. So that's another luxury. Okay, so let's open up the whole thing. This lid is heavy. This lid, well, this is a 7-foot grand piano. This lid is super, super, super heavy for a 7'2" grand piano that I have. This is a Yongchang 7'2" semi-concert grand piano. And I rebuilt this piano. I told you the story about this piano. I rebuilt it. This piano came to me garbage. I took the whole thing, took everything out of the piano, rebuilt it. And it sounds wonderful. I can't play it right now because people are sleeping. This piano, I rebuilt the whole thing. Not rebuilt it, I built the whole thing on this piano. I totally just, in my mind, I looked at this and I said, what if we made it smaller and that's compatible with the micro key station, which is pretty cool. Okay, so I'm going to bring the camera around and I'm going to show you the front of it. Let me open this up. You guys open up this one. This is light. This is very light. I can sit on it. I can still sit on it. Check this out. Okay, so I don't have a proper lip prop, so I use this for my lip prop right now. But if you can see, I don't know if you guys can actually see it, there's another lid lock right here. So there's another lid lock right here, and there's a lock right here, which I have. And spare piano parts, I have that. But the other lid lock is to actually keep the stabilization so the lid will not buckle itself. You might see this on a lot of grand pianos, like, what is this for? Yes. If you were to dance on this piano, that's what this is for, to keep the stabilization on top of it. You see how it's kind of flexible? Same thing here, flexible. Okay, so let's go in front of the pianos and I can show you what else that I did as an upgrade. First, we're going to go in front of the Yongchang. Now, as you can see with the Yongchang, beautiful black high polished piano, has dust all over it, sorry. And you can see this right here, the key cover, it's called a fall board. And the reason it's called a fall board is because it falls down just like that. You might see on an upright piano, they have the two-step fall boards. That's what they call it, two steps. Or you might see the sliding closed lid. That's also called a fall board, but it's a sliding one. Now, this one right here, pardon me for all the dust. I was working on that and I forgot to do this, but you see right over here, the fall board, it has two pieces. And it kind of makes it look like it's one piece. And what it is, take the fall board off. It's one straight piece. Of course, all of the polyester hides all of that, and it makes it look like one piece. And this is one piece right here, which curves up and goes straight to the top panel of the piano right over here where the lock is at. And there is, this is a second piece right here that it actually curves down, which is pretty cool. So, I'm gonna put this back and I can show you exactly. Now remember I told you guys that I was gonna do either the Hamburg version or the New York version of the Steinway. The Hamburg version on a piano has the curve, as you can see. Now you guys are gonna look at your pianos and say, okay, do I have a curve or do I have a pointed? Don't think anything differently as we're talking about pianos. So you see right here how the fall board actually curves. Yamaha, Yongchang, Hamburg Steinways, Busenhofers, Kawaii's, any Japanese, Korean pianos will have a curve. Mostly every American pianos, or to say, a lot of the American pianos these days have the points. And let me show you that on this one. Let's see if I could get a better camera view. I'm gonna have to come over here. There we go. Where the head? Oh, by the way, where the headphones is at? I left the screw there. Just not for the headphones. It was just basically to test out the strength ability of the sides of how thick it is, basically. And I forgot to take the screw out. So the New York Steinways, Baldwins, Chickerings, Lesters. Basically those kind of pianos, mostly a lot of New York pianos, not just New York, but a lot of American pianos have the pointed edge. So this is the fall board right here, and I have to make, let me take it out. See if I could. Yeah, I could. Hold on 1 minute. There we go. So I had to do the same thing. This part is actually from another piano, and I can't curve that wood. So I had piano parts laying around. I'm like, what can I use to make the curve up here? So I took part of the another piano up here. That's why it's a different color, and it came out really nice. And you see right here, it says fall board. That's what it is. It's a fall board. These have hinges on it, right here. And the reason for the hinges, let me put the fall board back in. Hold on 1 minute. It usually just squeezes in there nicely like that. There we go. The reason for the hinges, I mean, if you're not using it, of course it's like this, which you can do. And as you can see, it covers up that part. This was the hardest part of the piano to figure it out. When I had to do this whole piano, the rest, all of this was easy, and the way how I had it laid up in my head was easy. The fall board was the hardest part. On the side here, I got so many holes to try to figure out where to put the actual mechanism so it opens and closes correctly. So the hinges, just like on a Steinway D or a Steinway B, or any higher brand pianos, basically, they have a hinge right over here, so you can actually close it. I mean, you have more room for your hands. That's what it is. You have a lot more room for your hands and everything like that, and that's why the hinge is here. So when I close up this piano fully, this is not a lid prop, it's just a stick. Let me see what you guys are seeing. There we go. So when I close up the piano fully, and if I'm playing, and I was debating in my head if I should shorten this a little bit. I might just end up taking off the lid and doing that, is shorten it, the front part. But if I'm playing, and there's no sound right now because everybody's sleeping, but I promise you I'll get the sound in another video. I had to mark exactly where to put the pins in for the fall board, and I'm trying to see if this thing can actually go, soft close, like a soft close lid. Hold on 1 minute. You know what I found out? I was missing a piece right here. The reason I put this right here, is because I don't have any bumpers. Usually on this side, on the grand piano, you have bumpers, and yep, hold on, I got the wrong piece of wood, that's what I did. This is the right piece of wood, right here, there we go. Because I took a leveler and basically evened out, and right now it's not working correctly. I wonder why is that. Yeah, it's not working correctly. Ah, I see why. Because I have it in the wrong space. I have it in the wrong space. And usually I have two of them. Because this one right here. Just like that. There you go. And I'm gonna put the bumpers on a lot later. I recognize that because I have bumpers on the big one. So I need to put the bumpers on this one a little bit later. So when I close up the piano, just like that. Just like a regular piano, this could slam on your hands. This can actually slam on your hands, which is really realistic. Now, you see all these marks right here. In order for me to put the screws in, I had to shave them down. And that's why you have all these marks right here. Don't worry about those. They're all going to be covered up with veneer. Once I get the veneer, this is just right now, just a bare bone. So I was trying to decide the color, if I wanted white or black. White is very nice, it's very showy. The only thing about white, it turns yellow after a time if it's not used, and it gets dirty. Black is very, very nice. If I can't do a black high polish like my Yung Chang, but I'm gonna do a black satin, so it looks like a real nice Steinway. By the way, a lot of people's gonna ask me, Chris, are you gonna call it a Steinway? No. No, the reason of that is number one, copyrights. This is not a Steinway. Number two, I built it, and it has the digital in it, so it's not a Steinway. Number three is that, it's actually a Korg synthesizer. Let me open it back up. It's actually a Korg synthesizer inside of here. I can open this up just like that, and let's take you around to the other way. Actually, yeah, let's take you around here. I'm trying to get you guys a good picture. As you can see, this is all the stuff I'm working with. I'm just right now is a storage inside of it, but yes, it's a Korg micro station. Actually, let me show you that. I'm gonna turn it on. I can turn it on from right over here. Oop, sorry, that's my tripod. But yeah, it's a Korg micro station. And it's turned on, but there's no speakers, there's no sound out of it. There's no sound, so that's why I was using my headphones. And I think I already have figured out the pedals and how to make the pedal box. If I can make a piano, I could definitely make the pedal box. And the legs, you see on the grand piano right over here, the legs are basically spaded. I'm not gonna have spaded legs on this one, but they're gonna just be the regular straight legs, just like that. But you see right over here is the top of the spaded legs. That I am gonna have. I am gonna have that. The lyre, which is the pedal box with the lyre rods right over there. I am gonna have the same thing on this piano. And I don't know if you can hear it, but this is coming from my headphones. And you know what? Let me go in my room and get my bigger headphones. Hold on a minute. You can hear it much better. Okay. So I got the studio headphones. These are Sennheiser. And what I'm going to do is I'm just going to put it on the edge right over here and put this on the inside, because these headphones are loud. Take off the jack. Those other headphones, I call them my airport headphones, because they fold up. So I gotta figure out pedals. That's my next thing, is pedals, and I gotta figure out speaker configuration. I already have speakers underneath my bed, which I'm gonna dig out, and I'm gonna cue them up so it can be an amplifier. So this, the back of this is gonna be a full amplifier. I don't know if I want them underneath too. So I gotta figure out if I want them underneath and on top. But yes, it's gonna have a. But it's pretty cool. I mean, it's really, really cool. This is not gonna be the seat. I'm actually gonna make a customized seat for it. And I'm gonna find another padding, which is easy. I can find a padding anywhere. But I'm gonna make another customized seat for it, which is really easy to do. This has new wheels. So it has rubber wheels, so it won't scratch your floors and everything like that, which is really neat. And this is it. This is my baby. My baby grand, basically. Now, this is my 7-foot micro concert grand, I should say. I you know, it's weird, because when I was making this model, I thought I was actually making it attending to a 9-footer. But I'm looking at my piano, and I'm looking at if it was going to be shrunk down just a little bit, like somebody put it in a washer machine too long, or in the dryer too long, and it shrunk down. This is exactly how little it'll probably be. So this is going to be, I'm starting out with the 7-foot model. This is actually 4-foot, but since it's little and everything like that, it's equivalent to a 7-foot model, which is right here. So that's really cool. That's really cool. So there's gonna be more updates on this. I'm gonna go through the process step by step, because I think you guys are very, very interested in what else I'm gonna have to do with this. And that's it. That's basically it. I thank you guys for watching my videos. Click like, subscribe, follow me on everything. And go to my website. I just love the way how I did this. I keep opening and closing the fall board. It just flawlessly. Wait until I put the felts here. Give it a color, as I said, maybe black, just black satin, and put the felts, and it's gonna look like a real grand piano. This key slip, I don't know if I'm gonna use this key slip, even though it's the right color. What I'm gonna do is, this is a trim. I don't know if you guys can see it, but this is a trim from, like, the door, you know, door trims and everything like that. But it has an edge right over here that curves up and goes right here. So I was thinking about just cutting this and cutting that and using that as a key slip, which will make more perfect sense, because it has that scallop, or as you say, it has that beveled edge for a key slip. And this one is more of a key slip that looks like an upright, you know? So I want a more of a key slip that looks like a grand piano. But that's it, everybody. I might round, see if I could just a little bit round the edge right over here. So I'm thinking about that, just to see if I can round the edges just a little bit right over here. So even though it has a chord keyboard in it, a lot of people's gonna ask me, what are you gonna name this piano? And everybody, this is a K. Nicholson. This is my original K-N-I-C-H-O-L-S-O-N, K. Nicholson grand piano. And now since I made this small, it just proves to me that I can make a life-size model. Like if somebody wants it for a bar and they wanna stick a Yamaha P85 or a Casio Privia or a Korg concert piano, which I have over there, I can actually customize and make
make one of these for your pianos, or even a workstation, you know? I can customize this. And this also proves to me that I also can make upright pianos, which I did before. And when I was a kid, a lot of people, here, I'm gonna back up the camera a little bit so you guys can see everything. There we go. Here we go. So, I'm gonna tell you guys a story. When I was a kid, I grew up and I had a Casio keyboard that was an MT-35, little white thing, and it had six voices and four rhythms, and I was happy about it. We also had a big old upright. We had one of those big, humongous old uprights that was boxy, and it was black. And it was painted black. It was not just black, it was painted black. It was just weird. It was very, very weird having it, but you know what? If I didn't have that upright, I would not be playing piano right now. And what happened is that I went over to my cousin's house. No, actually, not just my cousin's house. I went over to the school, because we went to school, went to the auditorium, and they had a grand piano. That's the first time I ever saw a grand piano. And I was like, what is that? And you know, my dad, because my sister was performing in the band, and my dad said, "That's a grand piano, son. That's a big piano." I'm like, "Wow." I said, that's nice. I said, "That's a beautiful piano. I wish we had a piano like that." He said, "Oh no, that'll never fit up in the elevator." We lived on the 24th floor in the Bronx. And we had a big apartment. Well, it was actually a condo. We had a huge condo, and there was no way we could fit a piano that big in the elevator. So we had an upright. We had a big upright. Then I went to my cousin's house, and he had a grand piano. His, you know, my uncle and my aunt, they had a grand piano. And when I sat down and played, I'm like, this sounds way different from my big upright. My big upright kind of sounds old and everything like that. Plus, they had an old upright, which I inherited and stuff like that. But ever since then, I fell in love with the grand piano, and I couldn't afford one back then. Here's a dog. Everybody, this is Baby. I couldn't afford one back then, so I took my Casio MT keyboard, I also had a CT Casio keyboard. I had a Yamaha PSS-480. I took those keyboards, and I made a cardboard piano. So all I could think of was my imagination, tape, and a scissors. And that's all I had. I didn't even have a box cutter. I had scissors, I had boxes, because we had refrigerators, and my mom said, "Oh, why don't you build a fort or make this into a house?" And I said, "Yeah, yeah." Instead of that, make it into a house. I made it into a piano, stuck my keyboard in there, and had the lid up. It didn't look like this. It did not look like this. When I was a kid, it looked different. And I had a grand piano and everything like that. That was because we couldn't afford it back then, that was my interpretation of the grand piano. When we moved to Florida, same thing. I had my keyboards. I always wanted a grand piano, so the original cardboard grand piano got destroyed. After the years, it got destroyed. I tried sitting on it, I tried doing whatever. It just got destroyed, but the keyboard lasted. So I took the keyboard out, and when I got to Florida, I made two of these grand pianos, and actually no, I'm sorry, I made more than two. I made like four or five of them, and I kept two, but I gave the rest for friends, because my friends wanted them, but they didn't have a keyboard, so I had to make my own keyboards. Then my friends who had keyboards, I'm like, "Okay, let me borrow your keyboard for a week and take the measurements." I gave back the keyboards, took the measurements. I actually made basically something that looks like this, but it was all cardboard. It didn't have any wood parts on it, you know? And so gave it to friends. I made grands, and I started making uprights. I made an upright with a glass covering on it, and I figured out how to do carvings, like an old upright and everything like that, scallop work. And my mom said, "Wow, you really have a talent of doing this." I said, "Yeah, this is, not only I want to play music, I want to have my own piano company. I want to have my own piano factory, not piano company, factory." And so a lot of people kept on asking me, "Chris, do you still make cardboard pianos?" I'm like, "Yeah, it's still in my mind, but I don't make them anymore. I don't make them anymore." He said, "Well, you did really good jobs. I drew probably 20 models in my head. I still have the models in my head. I drew like 20 models of pianos from uprights to grands, everything from spinets to uprights to baby grands, concert grands, Victorian grands, and I never made those models. I had over like probably 20 pictures, 20 or 30 pictures. I had the pointed version, which is the box ones, and I had the curve version. I'm like, okay, which one looks better, the pointed or the curve of this model? So I say, okay, this is the model A1, A2, A3, A4, A5, you know? Just like how I make versions of my arrangements and songs. Like, say, for instance, Mr. Sandman, I did it in one version, I didn't like it. Another version came out, I didn't like it that much, or I used it for something else. Another version I made, I really liked it. I got many versions of Bye Bye Blues, and, you know, I still have many versions in my head of what I want, just to update. I keep updating and updating. So, when Korg made... Actually, when Yamaha made the PSS series, it was nice, but the PSS keys didn't look like a piano. So when Korg made the Micro series with the 61s, the keys resemble a piano. It didn't, you know, usually the black keys have kind of like a triangle on top of it with other keyboards like the Casio MT series. This one, it resembles a piano, plus the keys are matte finish. They're not high polished, they're like a matte finish, has a natural touch. I wish I had my sustain pedal. And so when they made this, I had the idea back in my head, why don't I start making pianos again? You know, why don't I start collecting these micro keyboards? And which I'm gonna do, I'm gonna look on the internet and use places I'm buying a lot of micro keyboards and make grand pianos and uprights again. And I'm like, so I had in my head many, many times to just debate. I play out with Twilight, which is my 75 note rhinestone piano, and I have the ukulele piano, which is a 64 note upright piano. When I looked at that piano, I'm like, that's not bad. When I had my piano store, I took a Show and Hut toy piano and built it as a Steinway upright, and I put Steinway and Sons on it, and I have that as a video which I'll share you. That's the dog crying. So what happened is that I looked at those videos and looked at them again. I'm like, Chris, you can do this. Get back your talent, what you can do, and show the world what you can do. So I was having it planned in my head. I'm like, Chris, what do I start with? How do I start before making a piano? Let's start from the ground up. So I started from the bass, did some measurements of the keyboard. I was gonna originally use my Korg Micro Key Air, and did a lot of measurements. And I said, what happened is that somebody, we went to Lowe's, and somebody bought a brand new lawnmower and left the box right there. I said, let's get that box. Let's get that cardboard box. So I was gonna make it just totally out of cardboard. And I didn't think to actually put the wood parts in it, and it makes it stronger. Look at this. Damn thing is not moving. I mean, if I try to do this, I can't. Cardboard will bend and it'll buckle in. I can't, it's not moving. So I put 6 layers of cardboard right here to right here. I put 2 layers here and 2 layers here, so there's 4 layers here. In between the 2 layers, I put wood. So there's wood throughout the whole areas. The reason that the wood's not showing is because it's like sections here, 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 very little sections here. And the cardboard gives it the shape of the curves that I want for it. And it gives it, you know, cardboard is basically like a pre-veneer of how you can actually shape your piano. And so that's exactly what I did. I put the cardboard in and it shaped the curves. Now you see these holes, you see these screws right here. And you can see right over here, that's another cardboard piece right here. But the screws, this is what's holding the cardboard in place with the wood on both sides of the piano. So that's basically it. That's why if I was gonna go like this cardboard, give you an example. This is just one piece of cardboard, but fold it up. Here, let's move this over here, back again. Fold it up. See how easy it folds? 5 pieces right here. That's like equivalent to that. You can still fold it. If I were to do this to that without the wood pieces, sorry about that. Look at that. It's with the wood pieces inside, it's just like building a real piano. When you put the actual veneer on the piano, people won't notice that you have cardboards in there. I know you're asking, you're telling me, oh, that's cheap because of cardboard, you know. Hey, whatever does a job, does a job. And this is a digital piano, so you really don't have to buy too much expensive stuff to do this. How much did it cost me to make this piano? Okay, so I got a soundproof board, which is here, so the sound could actually deaden the sound, or it could strengthen the sound when I put the other board on here, which is going to be something like this, with the speakers. So the soundproof board basically didn't cost me anything, but usually it could cost people like probably $50 a sheet, and I got like 10 of them over there. I got a soundproof board on the bottom, so it can control the sound. Once I cut the holes in the speakers and everything like that, there's going to be 2 speakers facing down, 2 speakers facing up, and it will level out the sound the way how I want it. So I have to plan and do a digitalization of how I want the speakers. On top of that, cardboard box didn't cost me anything because they threw it out. It was sitting in the parking lot of Lowe's, and they were just getting ready to pick it up. I said, no, let's put this in the back of the truck. I need this. The wood cost me a lot. I had some wood laying around. So the wood cost me a lot. It was like, say for instance, like this kind of wood right here. First, I got a real thick piece right there. That was basically like around $25. Then I had to cut out what it is, put the boards on top. The screws, say I had $25 worth of screws, so that's $50. The wood, this was $35. And here, let me get a calculator right now so I can, let's do the math. Trying to figure it out in my head is gonna be too much. So $25 for the plank of wood, which is like this thick. So 25 plus $25 for, what did I say? $25 for, there was something else I said $25 for, I forgot what it was, but you enlightened me. So it's another $25. So that's $50. This was $35. And this $35 sheet was a huge sheet. So I can make, I made 2 lids. Remember, the lid was double. So that's $35. So it's $85 for right now. Little pieces of wood, as all these little pieces that I have. No, the legs right here. The legs were $20 each. So it was actually two huge big legs, and I had to cut them in half. And so that was an extra like $40. The wheels were $4, so I bought two sets of those, so that's $8. The hinges, those hinges right there, there's two of them right there, that was $4 each, so that's $8. These hinges right over here, that was like a dollar each, so it's like $2. What else was there? This hinge right here, the piano hinge, this was $18. So let's put 18 right here. This part of the piano was free. I just cut it from another piano. This was from an old spinet, like a winter spinet. And I kept the keyboard and everything, but this part of the piano I definitely needed. And so somebody threw it out. I got the parts, that was free. The cardboard was free. The tools. I used a box cutter, that was $8. I used scissors, new scissors, that was like $25. And the tape. I gone through probably two rolls of tape, so that's $8 each. The microstation was when I first got it was like $350. And that's it. I mean, as of right now, that's basically it that I have gone through. So that's $560 just to build this. And I'm not finished yet, because remember, I have to get the veneer, I have to get the other stuff. Oh, the speakers that I have. I got two sets of speakers. One of them is a Samson's Bluetooth. So that is that was more than that. That was like $300 I got, because they're the good models. So plus $300. And I have M Audios. So the M Audios were like $150. Okay, so after I'm finished with this, for right now, without the veneers, because I don't know how much the veneers are going to cost me, that's $1,010 that it cost me to build this. Plus, I got to get more wood for the pedals. I think I already have the pedals, but I have to get the wood. I have to get the rods. I have to design the way how the rods are going to be. I might get, you know what, just like the Steinways, I might make the rods out of wood. But wood kind of bends a little bit, so I might just end up just doing the metal rods. Just like on this piano. And that's it. That's basically it. So right now I spent $1,010 for this, plus all the precious time that I have, which is priceless, to make this piano. And I absolutely just love it. I cannot express how much that I actually love it. My friend's out of the shower, so let me do this. I'm gonna go get my plug, put it in my Bluetooth speaker, and I'm gonna play for you guys. Hold on. Okay, so here's the easiest way I could do this. This is my Bluetooth speaker right here. This is a Bose I could put it to auxiliary. Put that right here. You know what? I took the wrong plug. So let me get the right plug, which is right over here. And this is it right here. This is a stereo jack that splits with a quarter inch. So let's see. Let's do a pre-setup. So this is what it is. So if I get the seat that's a little bit lower, I think I'll be fine with it. This is kind of feedbacking a little because that's a little speaker right there. Station, I could do anything. Right here, I'm gonna have each instrument. I'm gonna go through each and every instrument on the MicroStation, and I'm gonna tune it to the amplification that I have, so it sounds perfect. Even when you use a sequencer, it's gonna sound so perfect. Like this one, it's kind of low. It's kind of low, so. Synthesizer, if I want a synthesizer. First of all, I can play organ on this thing. If I can find where the organs are. I think it's in keyboards. It's harder for me to get used to these keys sitting like this, but... So that's called Pure Whirly, which is cool. You know, anything basically that I basically want to play with this piano. But the piano is loud, so I have to get the rest of the piano out. Not only that, I'm going to also have the Bluetooth capability in here. I figured out a way how to do that. And not just Bluetooth, but iPad capability. So I can actually play the Ravenscroft. Ravenscroft is my favorite piano. And when I play the Ravenscroft on this, it's going to just blow people away. It's just definitely going to do that. I wish I could produce my own piano sound for this. Which will be really good, and sample it straight into here. But, you know, I'm doing the best I can. Thank you so much, everybody, for watching this video. And do me a favor, click like, subscribe, follow me on everything. I know I took long and I talked too much, but little by little, I'm gonna show you different different things as it's going to go on with this little, I call this my micro concert grand. And the reason of that, the micro, is because of the chord microstation, which it is. So I kind of adopted that name, and concert grand, this is the micro concert grand right here. This is the micro semi concert grand. So I'm gonna make a micro baby grand. I'm gonna make a micro upright, micro spinet, but and micro concert grand, which is pretty cool. But I still call this a concert grand because this is like the biggest in this kind of form that it is. Thank you so much for watching this video. Do me a favor, click like, subscribe, follow me on everything. Go to my website, www.chrisnicholson.com. And if you want to know any more pointers how to make this piano, just message me. I'll be seeing each and every one of y'all. Bye, y'all.